The Shackleton was a post-war design, developed from the Lancaster directly and was used for maritime reconnaissance work. Powered by four Rolls-Royce Griffin engines, it produces a very distinctive note, different entirely to the Lancaster, as we hear it fly past and fade into the distance. DC-3 is the longest surviving transport aircraft of them all. Still in service, DC-3s have flown up to 70,000 hours. On this track we can hear a DC-3 with its Stratt & Whitney engines taking off past the microphone into the distance. One of the first jet aircraft to go into service with the Royal Air Force, the de Havilland Vampire, powered by its Goblin engine, had a very protracted start cycle. On this track, we can hear the start cycle being initiated in two stages as the electrical power comes in, followed by ignition and light up. And eventually, we can hear the engine responding to throttle. The first transonic aircraft to equip the Royal Air Force was the Hawker Hunter. On this track we hear a flight of five aircraft running in for a mock ground attack. Here we can hear a series of very fast flypasts by a section of Hawker Tempests. The Tempest was one of the fastest operational aircraft of the Second World War. It was the ultimate in piston-engine single-seat fighters, and the Tempest Mark V was powered by a Napier Sabre engine. Tempests were used against the flying bomb with great effect, tipping them by toppling their gyros, getting a wing under one wingtip of the bomb. The Swordfish, or TSR-2 as it was called originally, was powered by a Pegasus engine and was equipped with an inertia flywheel starter. On this track we can hear the two ground crew winding on the starting handle, speeding up the flywheel until the RPM is right for starting, and on the shout of contact, The clutch is engaged and the Pegasus starts. As it settles down into idle RPM, eventually we can hear the power increasing to run-up. The Swordfish, or TSR-2, then takes off into the distance. The aircraft we now know as the TSR-2 is a very different shape from the old Swordfish. A low-level strike bomber, it never went into service. Here we can hear the TSR-2, powered by two 30,000-pound Bristol Olympus engines with reheat, taking off. The Swordfish, with a maximum cruise speed of 85 knots, carried out some of the most daring attacks of the war with torpedoes against enemy installations. Imagine going to war in a Swordfish as it flies past at 85 knots. Designed to fly at supersonic speed very near to the ground, the TSR-2 flies past. The VC-10 has done much faithful service with British Airways. Powered by four Rolls-Royce Conways of 21,000 pounds thrust, here we hear the VC-10 approaching, flaring and landing, and the distinctive noise of the Conway engines is very evident as the aircraft touches down, and then we hear the power increasing once more as the aircraft goes into reverse thrust. Pratt & Whitney JT9D turbofans of the Boeing 747 produce the deep whirring note peculiar to this aircraft. Here we hear it on takeoff and climbing out into the distance. In spite of its size, the 747 is a much quieter aircraft than many smaller machines. Here we hear it on the approach, and during the landing phase, first the throttles are closed and then increased again in reverse thrust. It's fitting that the last track on the record should be that of Concorde. Here we hear Concorde, a different sound, deep and powerful. Constant thrust on the approach right down to touchdown, with engines of 38,000 pounds static thrust. Four Rolls-Royce Olympus engines. On this record, we have covered almost the entire span of aviation, from the Sopwith Camel of 1917 to the Concorde of today. I very much hope you enjoy listening to it, and that you will want to join us again in our next venture into the world of flying.